were built to last. We were built to win. We were built to be a dynamic offensive force, not a defensive survival mechanism. God has a plan for his church, and that is an eternal plan.
Welcome to the rock.
Welcome to the rock.
Welcome.
Welcome to the rock.
Welcome.
Hi, welcome to Solid Rock Christian Assembly. My name is Hina. Today, you're going to hear a message that's going to impact and transform your life. So I encourage you to open your heart and receive what God has in store for you.
Solid Rock welcomes you.
Today, I'd like to use as a subject, spiritual checkup. Spiritual checkup. My question is, are you healthy? Are you healthy? And really, I want to deal with this on a corporate level, not a personal level. So maybe we could say, are we healthy? Are we healthy? The church, which we are part of it, the church is a powerful entity. As a matter of fact, it is the most powerful force on planet Earth. The church is the most powerful force on planet Earth. Sometimes we look so much to individuals in the field of medicine and politics and so forth. We look at the great country, the United States of America. We look at the kind of power that they wield internationally. That when you become the leader of America, you become the leader of the free world because of the kind of dominance and influence that the United States possess. It's a great nation. It is the richest nation in all of human history, believe it or not. 300 plus million people, and at one point at the turn of the century, they were having something close to, 32.3% of the gross domestic product of the world, or not the gross domestic product, 32.3% of the assets of planet Earth. A population ranking somewhere 4.something% as it relates to the population globally speaking, but yet at the same time having over 31/3 of the world's asset at one point in time. We see companies like Apple, the first private-owned company, a visionary was able to start it there, an individual, and from there it became the first company to hit the $1 trillion mark in terms of a publicly traded company, the first of its kind to hit $1 trillion. You say, what is $1 trillion? It's only a million, or it's only 1,000 billions. The first company to do it. They said since the death of its founder in 2011, its shares went up by over 2,000%. Think of that for a moment, 2,000%. How big is that? That's 20 times. Had I known that, I could have envisioned that, then today I could have easily put some stuff in it, and then today I would be not retiring, but refiring. But we're seeing there the power of commerce. We've seen the political power, as I mentioned there. We've seen power in the area of medicine. We've seen power in the area of the military and all of those things. But at the end of the day, there are limits to the kind of power that man can wield. We are at a challenging time in our history where we pretty much have the capability to destroy ourselves. What an accomplishment. But in the process of all of that, even with the nuclear power and what's taking place in North Korea and confusion with the United Nations and so many other things happening across the globe today where leaders are just at a place where they're just so unstable and fickle and so many other challenges. In the midst of all of what we're looking at today, we see a world that is in crisis. And one of the reasons why that it's in crisis is the lack of proper usage of power. powerful individuals are out there, yet at the same time they are so limited because you've come to realize whether you're a Hitler or whatever the case may be, at the end of the day you may wield certain kinds of power, but Hitler, you're so limited that when you get into your corner, you just simply had to just sign out in life because you realize your limitation, and so he committed suicide. We see power being at work on so many other levels. But ladies and gentlemen, there are limits to it. There are physicians who are great at their job, yet at the same time, they're confronted with lupus. They're confronted with cancer. They're confronted with all kinds of diseases. And right there, they humble themselves to the reality that I am only human. You go out there and you pick up all kinds of award and scholarship, and then you realize again the limitation that your education just simply cannot save you. The reality is that regardless of what we think, who we think we are in life, we get to a place where we recognize that our power means so little, because we cannot guarantee our next breath. We cannot in any way stand here with assurance and certain level of confidence. As Jesus spoke, mention of the person who went out there, invested and accumulated all kinds of amazing, assets. And then finally he said to himself, oh my goodness, I am going to take it easy now. And I am going to say to my soul, soul, relax, you've accumulated much. Let's just get ready to plan the years of abundance. And then Christ interrupted all of that by saying, all of a sudden the voice came to him and said, tonight, you fool, your soul is required of you. So regardless of how we see ourselves, whether you were Mr. Universe or whatever the case may be, yesterday I was watching a documentary on Dr. J. He was born in 1950. He was a tremendous basketball player, had won championship with the ABA. They eventually sold him to the NBA to rescue the NBA at the time. And he was MVP many, many times, and then he won the championship in 1983 with the Philadelphia 76ers. Now, when you look at him, he was one of the most gifted person. They call him the Babe Ruth of basketball. He was just so gifted. He had the ability to do aerial assault in terms of his ability to glide through the air and to do all sort of amazing things. Some of his own opponents at times would stand there, and I remember Magic Johnson when he was going against him and he was going out of bound, and as he was going out of bound, he was able to take the ball, and Magic Johnson is like, his comment was like, he was in the air. We said to ourselves, at some point or another, he will have to come down. And he kept gliding and gliding, and we kept saying, when is he going to come down? You know, Magic, he's so dramatic. When is he going to come down? And as he continued to glide and he was going away, he was able to flip the ball, roll it, and that's one of the great highlights of NBA history. He was able to push the ball back while gliding out of bounds and put it in the basket. And Magic is like, can you do that again? Because even though they were his opponent, they were so amazed. I'm sure Coach Noe remembered that play. Do you remember it, Coach? Yeah. Even though they were his opponent, they were so mesmerized by that play. And your opponent sitting there like that, can you do that again? They say he was the coolest guy in sports. They said his athletic ability was just amazing. Dunking was not allowed in the NBA then because the purists often say that's too unrefined and too barbaric. But because of his ability, they had to introduce dunking and dunking competition and things of that sort. You look at Dr. G and you say, man, this guy is fit. This guy is just amazing and all of that. And then you look at him today. He's 68 years old. And then you realize, you know what? Time doesn't wait on any of us. We all go through phases. As a matter of fact, you look at him and you say to yourself, wow, that's Dr. J. I remember his commercial. I am not Dr. J, I'm Dr. Chopstick when I was a kid. And then you look at him today and you say, man, what happened to Dr. J? What happened? Guess what? The reality is that we all move on. We all age. But here is the thing, ladies and gentlemen. When you are in the army of Almighty God, you are with the God who does not change. You're with the God who does not age. You're with the God who is not limited by time or by space. You're with the God who is from eternity past to the very present, and the Lord that who will see the consummation of all things. He does not change. And ladies and gentlemen, I have good news for you also. There was a time when you were not. When George Washington walked the earth, you were not. When Jesus himself was on earth, you were not. When Martin Luther King Jr. walked the earth, many of you were not. Or even when he was assassinated. But here's the thing. There will never be a time that you will not be. And that's good news, depending on how you look at it. There was a time when you were not. But there is a time, there will never be a time where you'll never be. It's a matter of determining how you want to spend that time, how you want to spend eternity. The reality is that the God who created us, created the earth as a temporal kind of a system, so to speak. It's preparation for the great eternity. It's preparation for the days ahead. And we need to understand that. We are part of the church. We are part of the firstborn. We are part of the massive, powerful army that has been that was guaranteed victory even before we made our first step. We were built by God. We were built to last. We were built to win. We were built to be a dynamic offensive force, not a defensive survival mechanism. God has a plan for his church, and that is an eternal plan. You're part of it. God wants to do something amazing in you, and you need to understand that, recognize that, and be ready to embrace your divine purpose today. People may wither, plans may fail. All of our youthfulness and all of those things will come to a place. Billy Graham said the most surprising thing. They said, what is the most surprising thing for you as it relates to life? He said, my most surprising thing for me, I suppose, is that I'm old. He lived to be 99. It was surprising for him. Because he remembered the indestructible person who would be there for Youth for Christ. He remembered the ones who would stand there even while it's raining and everything, and he would stand there in the rain and would not move and preach the gospel. He remembered the awesome crowd and the fact that he would be needed night after night after night for six or straight weeks at Madison Square Garden or in California where his ministry started. He remembered how they did not want him in England, but once he got there, they did not want to let him go. He remembered that he was able to preach to over 200 million people in terms of live audiences and the kind of work that he was going like a motor. They said concerning him in his early days, he was immensely organized. He was almost like he could take any office and transform it and get people going, always having work to do. And that was the legacy of his ministry. But he said, the reality is that that's all history. I am now old. That's such a surprise. But ladies and gentlemen, here's the thing. As it relates to God's kingdom, as it relates to God's power, there is no lack or regression or any sort of diminishing return or anything like that. God's power remained constant. And I say to you today, we are the church. And when I say we are the church, it's not a simple thing. It is a great honor. We are the church. We are part of the most powerful thing on the earth. We're a privileged people. We're a royal priesthood, a chosen nation. We are priests and we're kings. We're ambassadors of God, his high commissioner. We are people who are representer, disciples of Christ, joint heirs with him and all of that. We are children of God. It is a great privilege. And we need to recognize that God placed his church. He said to Peter, and you are Peter or Simon, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The most powerful, destructible, diabolical force on earth right now or in this universe is the kingdom of Satan in terms of wicked power. He has won many battles over the years, leading people and seducing people and bring them into all kinds of chaotic lifestyle. He's ruined so many people down through the centuries. But here is Christ speaking, not concerning himself, but concerning the institution that he built. He said, I will build my church. In other words, I will build something with you and with me, with all of us here. And he's saying that church is more powerful than the kingdom of darkness. Yes, amen. What he's saying here is that the church is not a defensive mechanism that goes into some sort of defensive mold to keep itself from getting beaten and all of that. No, it's not a defensive stand to protect oneself. But he said, no, it's an offensive machine, which means that the church, it has the ability to charge, to say, we're coming at you and all of that. And then it's the gates of hell that's going to say, the church knows its purpose and its power. Brace yourself for impact. Brace yourself. Because what you're seeing there now is the impact of what the church is doing to the kingdom of darkness. And that was God's intention, that the church would have the power to demolish principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places and make a show of them openly, triumphing over them. And that's what Christ did. When Christ came on the scene and people were there, caught up with all kinds of demonic influences and so on, Christ would come and Christ would all of a sudden speak, start to speak into people's lives and circumstances, speak to demonic powers and all of that, cause them to be quiet and cause them to leave individuals who were bound by them and things like that. That's what Christ did, the authority he had. And then he said, the Bible puts it like this, the same power that resurrected Jesus Christ from the dead dwells within the same church. Am I making sense here? And so when you look at it now, that's why in Acts chapter 1, as they gathered together and prayed, Acts chapter 2, they experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And as Peter preached, 3,000 men came to Christ along with many others, so probably 10,000 people or so. And then Acts chapter 3, as they were moving to the temple at the time of prayer, all of a sudden he met the lame man there who was looking for silver and for gold. He said, silver and gold we do not have, but such as we have, we give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And then all of a sudden the Bible said he got up, he tested his leg, he started to walk, then he started to leap, then he started to jump, then he started to run, recognizing that even though he was 40 or so years old, or 40 plus years old, God was able to make right anything that was wrong. It's called the power that is in the church. They prayed in chapter 4, and then all of a sudden the place ended up shaking because of the presence of the power of God. They prayed, and then Peter's chains fell off, and Peter, in the next chapter, and then Peter, they were released, and they went out again and continued to preach. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Power is exciting, and there is power in the church. The church is the most powerful entity, and when we realize that and start to utilize the power in it, we will see amazing things happen. How many of you want an amazing lifestyle? Amazing living? How many of you want to experience power? I want to say to you today, you're in the church, the place of power. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The gates of hell will go into defense. And then all of a sudden, they will be getting blows of every form. They'll be getting jabs, which is just us simply just there fellowshipping. That's a jab. They'll be getting all kinds of blows. They're going to be getting uppercut. They're going to be getting body slap. What do you call it? The snatching thing. And then after a while, they're going to be getting the knockout, which is us at our best. All of a sudden, you'll see them lying there, and they don't even bother to count. Just get some sort of spiritual hospital bed and take the enemy and principalities and powers and take them there because of the recognition of the power that exists for the church. And this is no joke. This is the reality of the church when the church comes to the realization of who they are or who we are. Now God wants to do good things and great things in this church. And I'm going to be wrapping up here because I want to finish up next week. On this, or continue next week on this subject matter. But let me just say something here. When God created the church, his plan was not for the 12 apostles to sort of just get some sort of direction and then go lock themselves up and just survive and wait to die. I want to go to heaven and rest. I'm tired of trials down here. Is that the way the song goes? I want to go to heaven and rest. What else they said? They would sing again. All this different thing about going to heaven because we just want to get away from earth and all of that. I can't remember any more of the songs right here, but we are so hold the fort, for I am coming. Jesus answered still. You know, raise the answer back to heaven. By thy grace we will. What we're seeing there is a church that is so defeated, and we're kind of like, we'll make it, barely making it by the skin of our teeth. That's not God's plan for his church. But God developed for us to have a glorious, victorious church. It's not a religious machine, broken down religious machine, but it is a powerful entity, and God wants to do great things. It's not a place for depression and all of that where you need antidepressant or anything like that. No, the reason why church gets boring sometimes is because we have no power. The reason why church gets boring sometimes, no anointing. The reason why church gets boring sometimes, no vision. The reason why church gets boring sometimes is because as a people, we're anemic, we're weak, and we do not understand what we're part of. We're part of something great. And church is not a religious duty. No. Church is a massive, powerful recruiting army. It's a place when they call you there, you're looking and you're saying, I want to climb the ranks. Private, what do you want? He said, well, right now, I may be a private, but I have plans. I'm going to get to this level and that level and so forth. As a matter of fact, I see myself one day as a general in the army of God doing mighty things in God, in Christ's name. There are unlimited resources, unlimited opportunity. There, the church is an amazing place. It is an amazing thing. I don't know how to bring this across in the next 5 minutes to sort of, you know, create some sort of transition here or appropriate conclusion. But ladies and gentlemen, the church is amazing. It really is. God has great plans for you. And the day you joined the church, you did not join the church just to sort of secure your little salvation. You know, which I thank God for that. Sometimes people say, Jesus is coming. And you know what my concern is? What have I done? I said to myself, Lord, do I lack spirituality? I don't even want you to come. You know why I don't want Jesus to come? Because I feel that there are too many people, too many sinners out there. I feel that there are so many people who need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't want Jesus to come because I have unsaved loved ones there who are lost and they need to come to Christ. I have friends who need to know the gospel. I don't want Jesus to come because I don't feel as if I'm utilizing my giftings and my calling and my talent as yet. I don't even feel like I've come in to my true purpose as of yet. I do not want Jesus to come because so many souls need the gospel of Jesus Christ. And one of the challenges we have today is so many of us, we take an industrious approach as it relates to the world. Sometimes we say, my child is a doctor, and we're like, wow. And you know, congratulations. No, really. Oh, my child is a lawyer. Well, congratulations also. Yeah, my child is this, and my child is a preacher. Oh. Some of my friends look at me and they said to me, when I remember someone at York University worked there, and the person said to me, when the person heard I was going to move into ministry, said, no, Garth. Don't do that. Do something with your life, pretty much. Do something with your life. Like what? Yeah, like get yourself, you know, continue. Get yourself a good education. And then you can achieve so many things for yourself. You know, it's all about me, what I can do for myself. It's like at the end of the day, true satisfaction comes with a connection with divine mandate, divine purpose. And whether you get to the place where you have more degrees than a thermometer or whatever the case may be, it's absolutely nothing. One person said that the accomplishment of the PhD, I said, what was it like when you got your PhD? The person said, it was the saddest day on earth. Why was it the saddest day on earth? Because I was working so hard to get there. I thought when I got my PhD that the sun would have stopped for a moment to sort of just say congratulations. But then I realized that it's the same me from yesterday. And so, ladies and gentlemen, your satisfaction, your peace, your contentment, your purpose, and all of that, it comes through carrying out the purposes of Almighty God. And many of us are suffering from all kinds of anxiety and just outrageous anxiousness and challenges emotionally and all of that. You know why all these things are happening to us? It's because many of us have not come to the point of realization or the understanding of our purpose. Am I making sense yet? Because we were born to fulfill divine purpose. And today, I want to say to you, the purpose for us today is to form the church. Are we really the church of Jesus Christ? The purpose for us today is to ensure that the church is operating at maximum efficiency, maximum effectiveness, and accomplishing the purposes of Almighty God. All the other things will come about, but like a brand new car, you will have it today, and then all of a sudden you'll rev it and feel the excitement, but tomorrow it will calm down. Yes, 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 you can get yourself a great relationship and all of that, but let me tell you something. After a while, without purpose, even when you start to squeeze the life out of your spouse, you'll realize that there is something that's beckoning you to something deeper, because there is a purpose that goes beyond the hugging of your spouse. There's a purpose that goes far beyond your job. Many of you are at a point where you feel as if, oh, your job is the most important thing in life.
Thank you for joining us at The Rock, where we stand on the Word of God. We welcome you to join us on Sundays at 10:30 a.m. for our worship services, and Wednesdays at 7 p.m. for our interactive Bible study and prayer meetings. You can find more information on our website or contact us on this number. We look forward to seeing you next time at The Rock.